Stand with me as we get ready to welcome our next storyteller to the stage. Please give a warm welcome for Miss Renee Weber.
Longer, straighter. Mm-hmm. I may perm this stuff. Mm-hmm. A weave, long extensions to my behind, or a wig. Oh, that'll make me beautiful. These are just some of the messages that I have experienced over the last 35 years as a stylist. This conditioning has chained us from generation to generation. The first healing that happens in my sacred space is the unchaining of the mind. My beautiful guests are prescribed the knowledge of their beauty, the symbolism of their history, and the story that our hair could tell. It could tell who we are, our economic, our social status, our marital status, or where we come from in Africa. When I was a child, my mom couldn't do hair at all. Occasionally, my grandmother, she would press my hair. I walked around with a matted afro. Could you imagine the trauma I had to endure? You're black, ugly. I didn't get attention from the boys. My self-esteem was L-O-W. When I was 13, my sister and I, we got into a fight with a group of girls in East Baltimore. I was arrested. My mugshot was taken. I received 1,000 hours of community service. I asked, can I do all that time in the salon? And to my surprise, they said yes. That began my journey in the salon, me being healed, and me healing others. So now I have my own salon. I've seen hundreds, maybe thousands of clients. And, you know, they tip me well. I gathered that those tips come from the natural opioids that we receive when we get in our hair. Did you know that there are several nerve endings in your scalp, and when it's massaged and stimulated, when you get your hair shampooed, then endorphins are released, that feel-good hormone. The same hormone that runners get when they get that runner's high, and also the same hormone released during having sex. Let me introduce you to a client. Introduce your client. All right, we're gonna call her Mrs. Hope. She was a beautiful soul. She tipped me well also. She came into the salon for an appointment and she dropped a bomb on me. She told me how she received the diagnosis that she had esophageal cancer. She was devastated. She said that, you know, she didn't know what she would do if she lost her hair. So fast forward, 2 weeks later, she had an appointment, and I had incense burning, aromatherapy, VIP salon. So she couldn't keep her excitement in, though. She said, I kept my hair. So I put her apron on, began to wash her hair. I know about that. And as we had very comforting conversations, and she expressed how she met a young girl, a cancer patient, 13 years old, and she was grateful for life because that young girl might not get to see the 60 plus years that she experienced. So I washed her hair, detangled, you know, a little shedding came out, but that shedding turned into clumps of hair in my hand. So I transferred from the sink to the trash can, the sink to the trash can. I couldn't take it anymore. I had to take a moment. I left the room. The tears began to flow because I realized I needed to be strong for my clients. I went back, continued to shampoo, and I told her that her hair, carefully selecting my words, I said, "You lost all of your hair." She sighed and said, "When you are faced with life or death, hair is not a priority." So, you know, needless to say, I didn't charge her for her hair. She left with a smile on her face, but I still needed time to mourn the loss of her hair. So fast forward, I lost a client from breast cancer, and she was really, really close to me. And I didn't get out of bed for 3 days. 3 days. Who heals the healing, y'all? Who heals the healing? So I almost forgot about an appointment I had with a client. So she came in. Let me introduce you. Her name is, let's call her Dr. Faith. All right, call Dr. Faith. So Dr. Faith is an internal medicine doctor. She came in often. She told me how she wasn't respected as a medical doctor in the medical field. You know, always turmoil stories from job to job. She resigned this job, that job. Superior to superior. But during our talk sessions in the salon, you know, talking is very therapeutic in my salon. I told her, you need to fire your boss. Be your own boss. So, guess what? She started her own practice. She came, and every time she comes in now, there's a sense of calm and peace. She's my doctor. So, on that day that she came in, though, she looked at me and she said, "What is going on?" I put my head down and I cried. I cried and said, "I think I'm having a breakdown." And she said that, you know, just relax, let's just talk about it. But it was difficult. All that I had to take in from clients is a heavy load. So who heals the healer? I'm about to tell you who heals the healer. She asked me if I ate. I said, I cried. She asked me, did you drink water? I cried. So she said, okay, I'm gonna cut some watermelon, eat this watermelon, drink this water, you're gonna be okay. She said, cancel all your clients for the day, you need to take a break. I said, whoa, don't cancel my clients, that's my money. So, but with her care and attention, she sat with me until I calmed down. I realized I was mourning the loss of my client. I was overworking myself. And also, I was dealing with childhood trauma. You know, we had trauma. So she sat with me and I calmed down and I realized that, you know, at some point, we all are going to be healers and need healing. So that is who heals the healer. Each and every one of you, you heal the healer. At some point, you're gonna need healing And you're going to need to be the healer for someone else. So what I want you to do is go and give somebody a skeleton.